The 25th of November 1983 saw the 20th anniversary special, The Five Doctors, transmitted in the UK. Written by Terence Dix and directed by Peter Moffat, the special gained 7.7 million viewers as part of the Children in Need charity telecast night. Ideas for a 20th anniversary stretched as far back as 1981, as producer John Nathan Turner was already planning for the event. Originally, JNT hoped to celebrate the milestone during the programme's regular season, but was concerned because the revamped schedule introduced for season 19 meant that Doctor Who started broadcasting in January and would only run for 13 weeks. On July 21st, 1981, JNT wrote to head of series David Reed, requesting that Doctor Who revert to an autumn transmission schedule by bringing the start of season 20 forward to the autumn of 1982. A suitably celebratory adventure could then be included in the programme's season. Unfortunately, Doctor Who's leading man, Peter Davison, was also starring in a BBC sitcom called Sink or Swim. This was recorded during the summer for transmission in the autumn, and these dates would have to be postponed to accommodate a revised Doctor Who schedule. Reed discussed the matter with BBC One controller Alan Hart, but Hart was not interested in delaying the successful Sink or Swim. Hart, however, was not unsympathetic towards Doctor Who, and suggested that a special could be recorded to air between seasons in November 1983. This was communicated to JNT on August 25th. Hart suggested that the budget for two of season 20's planned 28 episodes could be diverted to this special, in the same way that season 19 had been truncated by two episodes in order to fund the spin-off K9 and Company. It was thought that additional funding might come from BBC Enterprises, the commercial wing of the corporation, who reaped a significant profit from their exploitation of Doctor Who. Nathan Turner approached Brian Parkin, head of BBC Enterprises, about participating in the special, but although Parkin was interested, it soon became clear that an agreement could not be finalised quickly enough. Another potential partner in the venture was the Australian Broadcasting Commission, who had been broadcasting Doctor Who since the 60s and had already co-produced such sci-fi fare as Day of the Triffids and the second season of Tripods with the BBC. JNT had courted the ABC since he took over Doctor Who, with Tegan Jarranca's nationality an explicit overture to the Antipodean broadcaster, but so far the BBC and ABC had been unable to come to an agreement with regards to Doctor Who. In May 1982, Hart approached the ABC about funding the anniversary programme. This time, the two parties were able to come to terms on a co-production arrangement, with the ABC agreeing to contribute $60,000 to the Doctor Who special. With funding now in place, JNT turned to the business of assembling the special. Following the lead of the 10th anniversary adventure, The Three Doctors, he wanted to reunite the Doctor's various incarnations. His first point of contact was Tom Baker, the Fourth Doctor, whom JNT felt might be the least interested in such a proposition. Baker had only just left Doctor Who after 7 seasons, but in April indicated that he would consider appearing in the anniversary special, depending on the script. John Pertwee, the Third Doctor, and Patrick Troughton, the Second Doctor, were contacted during the summer, and although Troughton noted that his availability could be an issue. William Hartnell, the First Doctor, had passed away in 1975, so JNT decided that he would have to find another actor to play the role. Nonetheless, he was eager that the special somehow acknowledged this recasting. He would later receive the blessing of Hartnell's widow, Heather. The two actors Nathan Turner considered to replace Hartnell were Jeffrey Baildon, who had played Organon in The Creature from the Pit, and Richard Herndl, whom he had seen in the Assassin episode of Blake 7, broadcast in November 1981. Nathan Turner finally settled on Richard Herndl, as he had come to feel that Baildon's time as the lead actor in the children's series Cat Weasel meant that he was too recognisable to effectively slip into the role of the First Doctor. Herndl's career had begun with productions of Shakespeare before branching out into radio, film and television. Herndl's enormous list of credits includes Spindo, The Power Game, Oil Strike North, Love in a Cold Climate, The Avengers, Steptoe and Son and Doomwatch. To write the special, script editor Eric Sayward lobbied for Robert Holmes, a former script editor who had not written for Doctor Who since The Power of Crawl in 1978. Sayward had recently viewed a number of old Doctor Who serials and had been impressed by Holmes' contribution to the programme, particularly stories such as The Talons of Wang Chiang. Nathan Turner's preference since taking the reins of Doctor Who had been to avoid the use of writers who had preceded him on the programme, but he agreed to meet with Holmes. Holmes also had reservations about participating in the project. He always disliked using other writers' characters and plumbing past continuity, and he was well aware that the anniversary special would force him to do both. Indeed, JNT had already decided that Anthony Ainley should return as the Master, while Sayward wanted to include the Cybermen in a major role. It was agreed, however, that the Daleks would not be utilised. It was expected that much of the special would be recorded on location, and the Daleks presented extraordinary challenges beyond the confines of the TV studio. On July 15th, the special was officially greenlighted by David Reed in the form of a 90-minute telefilm. On August 2nd, Holmes was commissioned for a storyline entitled The Six Doctors, which would also feature the Doctor's granddaughter Susan, who had travelled with the First Doctor, as well as Jamie McCrimmon, companion to the Second Doctor. To account for the First Doctor's altered appearance, Holmes devised the notion that he and Susan would actually be cyborg infiltrators dispatched by the Cybermen, hence the additional Doctor in the working title. As the summer progressed on, JNT began securing the services of its large principal cast. The current Doctor Who regulars, Peter Davison, Janet Fielding and Mark Strickson, were contracted on July 29th, as were John Pertwee and Anthony Ainley. They were followed on August 2nd by Patrick Troughton, who had been assured that the filming dates for the telefilm would not interfere with the April recording of his sitcom Foxy Lady, and August 18th, he had secured Carol Ann Ford as Susan. Meanwhile, it had become clear to Saywood that Holmes was struggling with the Six Doctors. He recommended that a reserve storyline be commissioned and approached Holmes's predecessor as Doctor Who script editor, Terence Dix, who had most recently written Season 18's State of Decay. Terence Dix agreed to step into the breach should Holmes lead the project. Meanwhile, JNT discussed the special with Nicholas Courtney, who was reprising his role as the Brigadier for the forthcoming Mortian Undead. Courtney was eager to take part in The Six Doctors. He was contracted for the telefilm on October 4th, 2 days before Richard Herndl as the First Doctor was booked. On October 13th, Holmes told Saywood that he was unable to proceed with The Six Doctors. Saywood was understanding and suggested that Holmes might instead be interested in writing a wholly original four-part story for Season 21, which would eventually become The Caves of Androzani. Saywood and Nathan Turner immediately met with Terence Dix, who would start from scratch with a brand new storyline. Terence Dix's only request was that he be saddled with neither the Daleks nor K9. He was commissioned to prepare an outline for the telefilm on October 18th. In addition to the Five Doctors, Tegan, Turlough, Susan, Jamie and the Brigadier, Dix was asked to include Sarah Jane Smith in his plans. This would ensure that each Doctor was paired with one iconic companion. Originally, JNT had hoped that Lala Ward would return to play Romana, opposite Baker's Doctor, since the two actors had been married in 1981. Unfortunately, their breakup scuttled these plans, and JNT's thoughts turned to Elizabeth Sladen, who had recently returned to the role of Sarah Jane in K9 & Company. JNT continued to be anxious that Tom Baker would opt out of the anniversary special, but to his surprise, the actor did remain interested, although he would not confirm his involvement until Terence Dix's script was all ready. There was also concern that the salary necessary to secure John Pertwee for both studio and location work would be beyond the confines of the telefilm's budget. By the start of November 1982, Terence Dix's storyline had gained the title The Five Doctors. The notion of Herndl playing an imposter First Doctor had now been abandoned. Ironically, Terence Dix decided to draw upon Holmes's own development of Gallifreyan culture in stories such as The Deadly Assassin, setting the action on Gallifrey and incorporating crucial roles for both Barusa, the Doctor's former teacher at the Time Lord Academy, and Rassilon, the legendary founder of Time Lord Society. Barusa presented Terence Dix with the opportunity to surprise viewers with the identity of the mastermind behind events, since the Master was felt to be too obvious a culprit, although he and the Cybermen would still appear prominently. In addition, Terence Dix included the Autons, well-remembered monsters which had been introduced during his time as Doctor Who script editor. He was also inspired by the imagery of Robert Browning's poem Child Roland to the Dark Tower Came, originally published in the 1855 collection Men and Women. Terence Dix's script for The Five Doctors was commissioned on November 16th. Tom Baker was sent the first clutch of pages on December the 9th, and the actor indicated that he was agreeable to appearing. Things were starting to look up. The issues with John Pertwee's fee had also been resolved, the actor having agreed to a pay cut because he was very eager to play the Doctor again. The Five Doctors was allocated the production code 6K, which had previously been reserved for The Return, a Dalek story intended to conclude Season 20, which had been cancelled due to industrial action. The Five Doctors would be directed by Peter Moffat, who had recently helmed Mordred Undead. Moffat was not JNT's first choice. He had originally approached Waris Hussein, who directed the very first Doctor Who serial, An Unearthly Child, but although Hussein considered the proposal, the two had not been able to come to terms. JNT had then approached Doctor Who veteran Douglas Camfield, whose last work had been on 1976 The Seeds of Doom. However, JNT had previously refused an inquiry Camfield had made about returning to Doctor Who. Still hurt by this rejection, Camfield had reluctantly declined the new offer. Since Tom Baker's Fourth Doctor was arguably the most popular of the five incarnations, Terence Dix decided to assign him the strongest role in the script. It would be the Fourth Doctor who would travel to the capital using the Master's recall device and unmask Barusa as the traitor. Although Terence Dix wanted to portray events as if this Doctor might actually be the villain. The First Doctor, on the other hand, would have a comparatively minor role. He would remain in the TARDIS with Susan and Turlough, while the Second, Third and Fifth Doctors travelled via the three different routes to the Dark Tower. Several characters from the Season 20 story, Ark of Infinity, also set on Gallifrey, were added to the script. In addition to Barusa, now Lord President as in that serial, these included Chancellor Falia, Commander Maxwell and the Castellan. It was agreed that Chameleon, a new robot companion introduced in The King's Demons, now the final story of Season 20 after the loss of The Return, would not feature in The Five Doctors. Towards the end of December, problems with the cast began to surface. First of all, it became apparent that Fraser Hines would not be able to reprise the role of Jamie McCrimmon due to his obligations to the soap opera Emmerdale Farm. Terence Dix consequently adjusted his script to pair the Brigadier with the Second Doctor. It was now hoped that there might be money available to fly Katie Manning back from Australia to play Joe Grant opposite the Third Doctor. Then, on December 29th, J&T was flabbergasted to learn that Tom Baker had completely changed his mind and was no longer interested in appearing in The Five Doctors. Tom Baker subsequently visited J&T in person to explain that he could not bear returning to the programme that he had just left after so many years. However, he did consent to the idea of incorporating material from Sharda, the original finale of Season 17, which had been abandoned partway through recording due to the labour strike. J&T had already investigated this option as a backup plan to ensure that the Fourth Doctor was represented some way in the telefilm, and the use of those scenes was cleared on January 10, 1983. The loss of Tom Baker forced Terence Dix to perform substantial rewrites on the script. The focus now shifted to the current Doctor, with the fifth incarnation taking over the Fourth Doctor's investigation in the capital. However, the subplot concerning this Doctor's possible villainy was deleted, as it was felt that it was not appropriate to Davison's portrayal of the Time Lord. Sarah Jane would now accompany the Third Doctor, while the First Doctor would journey with Tegan to the Tower of Rassilon, and Turlough and Susan would remain behind in the TARDIS. The Fourth Doctor and Romana would now be trapped in a time eddy. Terence Dix's idea was that this halted the process of each Doctor being captured, explaining why the Fifth Doctor did not fall victim to the time scoop. The cast remained in flux throughout early 1983. It was briefly hoped that John Levine might be able to appear as Benton, now promoted to Sergeant Major, in the scene at Unit HQ. Ian Marta was also contacted about reprising his role as Harry Sullivan, but the actor had commitments in New Zealand. Of the four guests RTs from Ark of Infinity invited back for the Five Doctors, only Paul Jericho, the Castellan, was able to accept. For the fourth time in four appearances, Barusa would assume a regenerated form, with Philip Latham taking over for Leonard Sachs. The unavailability of Elspeth Gray and Colin Baker meant that Chancellor Falia and Commander Maxwell would be replaced with two new characters, Chancellor Flavia, played by Dinah Sheridan, and an anonymous commander, played by Stuart Blake. On February 11th, writers Mervyn Haseman and Henry Lincoln agreed that their beloved Troutonera monster, the Yeti, could appear in The Five Doctors. By now, it had also been decided that a lone Dalek should appear in the story, in a scene that could be recorded in the studio. However, Sayward dropped the sequence involving the Autons, which he felt was too long and costly. This would have seen Sarah Jane materialise in the Death Zone in a ruined replica of a high street. A collection of fallen mannequins is revealed to be a battalion of Autons, and Sarah Jane is saved by the Third Doctor in Bessie. During February, Deborah Watling, Victoria Waterfield, Wendy Padbury, Zoe Herriot, Caroline John, Liz Shaw, and Richard Franklin, Mike Yates, all agreed to make cameo appearances as phantom images in the Dark Tower. Watling, Padbury, and John were contracted on February 21st. Unfortunately, Watling was cast in the Dave Allen show several days later and reluctantly backed out of the Five Doctors. Another former companion, Louise Jameson, Leela, offered her services for the telefilm, but there was no opportunity to insert her into the storyline. Location filming largely took place in Gwynedd, Wales, beginning on March 5th when the Eye of Orion scenes were recorded at Plas Brondorn in Llanfroffen, the estate of Lady Annabel William Ellis. Her late husband, Sir Clow William Ellis, was the architect who had designed Port Merion, the Italiante village at which The Mask of Mandragora had been filmed. Also completed at Plas Brandau was the glimpse of the First Doctor in the Rose Garden, marking Richard Herndl's first performance in the role. On March 7th, J&T was able to arrange for Fraser Hines to be released briefly from Emmerdale Farm so that he could replace Watling in the Dark Tower sequence. Originally, the Phantoms were identified when Victoria referred to Lethbridge Stewart as Brigadier instead of Colonel, the character's promotion having occurred after Watling's departure from Doctor Who. Now the Doctor would recall that the Time Lords had erased Jamie and Zoe's memories of their travels in the TARDIS, which meant they shouldn't recognise Lethbridge Stewart at all. As Terence Dix completed the final rewrites necessary for the Five Doctors, he also brought to a close his association with televised Doctor Who. He would continue to be involved in the writing of spin-off media. and became a frequent contributor to the range of Doctor Who DVDs until his death in 2019. The 7th was also the first of three consecutive days at Carrag Wyfall Gron near Festynoin, where scenes in the wasteland of the Death Zone were filmed. More of this material was recorded at the nearby Manod Quarry on the 10th and 11th. These included the subterranean scene involving the Yeti, the costume for which was a relic from 1968 to the Web of Fear, and which was now found to be infested with fleas. The Raston robot sequence was filmed at Manod, with JNT stepping into the director's shoes for some second unit shots due to the large amount of material that needed to be captured. By now, it had been learned that the Eye of Orion footage had been irreplaceably damaged, forcing the production team to return to Place Bandau for a remount on the 11th. Strickson had to cut a holiday short in order to return to Wales. Further work on Manod Quarry took place on March 13th and 14th, including the scenes of the Third Doctor and Sarah Jane reaching the Dark Tower. As scripted, this involved the Doctor constructing a makeshift hang glider using the Raston robot's spare equipment and his own cloak. Unfortunately, the visual effects department had been unable to construct a realistic prop, and Pertwee refused to go ahead with the scene, which he felt to be preposterous. The last day of filming in Wales was March 15th, with the remaining Death Zone material completed at Crwm Bycan near Llanbedr. Moffat's team then returned to England for additional recording on the 17th. Denham Green in Buckinghamshire provided two locations. Tilehouse Lane was the roadway from which the Third Doctor is abducted, while Hayling's House, a disused building owned by the Ministry of Defence, posed as Unit HQ. Sarah Jane's home and its end, Rivens, was actually on West Common Road in Uxbridge, Middlesex. Terence Dix had relented in his objection to the use of K9 in this scene. John Leeson returned to provide the robot dog's voice. On the same day, a photo call was held with Peter Davison, John Pertwee, Patrick Troughton, Richard Herndl, Carol Ann Ford, Nicholas Courtney, Elizabeth Sladen, and the K9 prop. Tom Baker had also promised to attend this event, but did not appear. Suspecting that this might occur, JNT had arranged for a wax replica of the Doctor in costume, normally on display at Madame Tussauds, to be available. The presence of the dummy was a source of much merriment for the cast. One day at the Ealing Television Film Studios then took place on March 18th for the scene of the Doctor and Sarah Jane on the roof of the Dark Tower, as well as the material at Unit HQ. The five Doctors then moved into BBC Television Centre Studio 6 for 3 days, beginning on the 29th. The set for the TARDIS console room was needed throughout the block, while the first 2 days otherwise concentrated on scenes in the capital, including Baruse's secret sanctum. Also completed on the 30th was the First Doctor and Susan's encounter with the Dalek. The final day, March 31st, was dedicated to sequences set in the Dark Tower. In post-production, a clip from the final episode of the Dalek Invasion of Earth was added to the Five Doctors as a pre-title sequence, ensuring that Hartnell did have a presence in the special. For the Fourth Doctor and Romana's release from the Time Eddy, an extract from Sharda Part 1, in which the pair approached the gates of Cambridge, had originally been selected. However, JNT was keen to depict all the Doctors departing in the TARDIS, and so a clip from Episode 3 was used instead, even though it did not match up as well with the abduction sequence, which was also taken from the opening episode. Meanwhile, composer Peter Howell devised a special version of the Doctor Who theme for the closing titles, combining the original Delia Derbyshire version with the contemporary arrangement devised by Howell himself. Although it was originally hoped that the Five Doctors would air on November 23rd to precisely mark the 20th anniversary of Doctor Who, this was ultimately delayed by 2 days so that it could be transmitted as part of the BBC Children in Need charity special. This meant that, for the first time ever, an episode of Doctor Who would premiere outside the UK, as PBS station WTTW in Chicago transmitted the Five Doctors on the anniversary date itself, to coincide with the Spirit of the Light convention about to take place in that very city. The Five Doctors was promoted with an appearance on the front cover of the Radio Times, its first since the debut of Season 11 10 years earlier, and the only time during the 80s that the programme would be honoured in this way. The target novelisation of The Five Doctors was originally scheduled for release on November the 24th, with the idea that this would be the day after transmission. In the event, it actually began appearing on store shelves 2 weeks before the telefilm's air date, much to JNT's dismay. This was the only instance in which a Doctor Who novelisation was published in advance of a story's broadcast. The special begins with an unknown entity using the time scoop to bring several of previous incarnations of the Doctor, his former companions Susan Foreman, Sarah Jane Smith, and Brigadier Lethbridge Stewart, and enemies such as the Daleks, the Cybermen, a Raston warrior robot and a Yeti, from their respective time streams into the Death Zone on Gallifrey. The entity's attempt to grab the Fourth Doctor and Romana ends up trapping the two in the time vortex. The Fifth Doctor senses the disruption of his own timeline, and with Tegan in Turlough travels to Gallifrey via the TARDIS, also ending up in the Death Zone, unable to travel farther with the TARDIS due to a force field projected by the Tomb of Rassilon. The various doctors lead their companions towards the tower while avoiding the hostile forces on the planet. At the Citadel on Gallifrey, the High Council of the Time Lords have also detected the disturbances in the Doctor's timeline and a power drain from the Time Scoop, and Lord President Barusa has the Master, the Doctor's arch-enemy, summoned to help rescue the Doctor, offering the Master a new set of regenerations and a pardon for his misdeeds if he succeeds. The Master accepts and is given a recall device by the Castellan and a copy of the High Council's seal before he is transmitted to the Death Zone. The Master encounters the Third Doctor, who dismisses him and accuses him of making the seal himself, before finding the Fifth just as they are surrounded by Cybermen. The Master is knocked out by a Cyberman's gun firing, and the Doctor finds the recall device to return to the Citadel. When the Master awakes, he makes a pact with the Cybermen to lead them to the tower if they will give him his life, but tricks them into falling for the Death Zone's traps. The Cybermen too have an ulterior motive, planning to kill the Master when he outlives his usefulness. As the other Doctors and companions converge on the tower, the Fifth Doctor works with the Council, discovering the recall device given to the Master included a tracking signal to lead the Cybermen to him, and foul play is suspected. The Castellan is found to possess the forbidden Black Scrolls of Rassilon, and he dies while attempting to escape an invasive mind probe. When the Doctor returns to the High Council to report, he finds President Barusa missing, but soon discovers a secret room with Barusa at the controls of the Time Scoop. Barusa reveals he ceased to be the President Eternal of Gallifrey, and needed the Doctor to disable the force field over the tomb as to gain immortality from Rassilon's ring and rule forever. The Five Doctors was heavily anticipated throughout 1983, with cast appearances on BBC News, the conventions in both Longleat and Chicago, the many references to past monsters in Season 20. In 1983, the BBC was going mad for Doctor Who, and you could not escape the hype. But after all the build-up, the struggle to get a workable script, the ever-changing list of companions that could return, did it live up to the hype? In my opinion, it most certainly did. The Five Doctors is a great anniversary tale that celebrates the programme's long history, but also looks ahead to its future. Richard Herndl, I think, gives a terrific performance as the First Doctor, and does a brilliant job with what was seemingly a hard choice for the production team regarding the First Doctor. Herndl brings all the gruffness and authority to the role that Hartnell originated. When he walks into the Fifth Doctor's TARDIS demanding to know why young people are suddenly in it, it almost seems like the First Doctor never left.
Who are you?
More to the point, what are you young people doing inside my TARDIS?
It's his TARDIS.
And who might he be?
The Doctor.
Good grief.
I particularly love his partnership with Tegan and how he won't put up with any of her nonsense.
How long do you plan to play pitch and toss?
Patience, child.
But also can be protective of her when he assures her that fear is just an illusion.
I feel weird, Doctor.
Full of strange fears and mysterious forebodings.
That's it.
No, as a matter of fact, I don't. It's all illusion, child. We're close to the domain of Rassilon, whose mind is reaching out to attack us. Just ignore it as I do.
How?
Fear itself is largely an illusion.
I like how the First Doctor isn't affected by the illusions of the Dark Tower. Being the wisest of the Doctors, he won't be falling for it. It's very appropriate that he is the one to figure out what the old proverb means and foils Barusa, knowing full well that Rassilon's immortality is a curse.
Did you know what would happen?
I'm so sorry, I suddenly realised what the old proverb meant. To lose is to win, and he who wins shall lose. It was all part of Rassilon's trap to find out who wanted immortality and put him out of the way. He knew very well that immortality was a curse.
Patrick Troughton returns to the role as the Second Doctor with fantastic ease and is a complete scene stealer throughout. Being allowed everywhere and laughing at authority, it's like he never left at all.
Sorry, sir, you're not allowed in there.
Not allowed?
Me?
I'm allowed everywhere.
Ah, how did you know?
I saw it in the Times.
That's impossible. The reporter's still here.
Tomorrow's Times. Who is this?
That's Colonel Crichton, my replacement.
Ah. Yes, mine was pretty unpromising, too.
Excuse me for a moment.
You've had this place redecorated, haven't you? Don't like it.
Out of all the Doctors in this story, he seems to be having the most fun and revels in the adventure and excitement. I love how cheeky he is to his other Doctors and barges past them when they are reading the old High Gallifreyan text. His scenes with the Brigadier are fantastic to watch. It's honestly a shame that this Doctor couldn't have been exiled on Earth with the Brigadier in unit. One of my favourite moments is when he hides behind the other Doctors when Rassilon offers them immortality.
And what of you, Doctors? Do you claim immortality too?
That's very
no, nice. No, my lord.
Now, something tells me that wasn't in the script. John Pertwee returns to be the dashing action hero once again, and his scenes with Sarah Jane are fantastic as well. They always had a very nice father-daughter relationship during season 11, and it equally shines through here. This story is also the closest the Third Doctor got to facing the Cybermen, even if it was watching them get kebabbed by the Raston robot. It was great that the Third Doctor managed to see the Master again, arguably his most iconic enemy, definitely not believing that his best enemy has come to help him. Peter Davison, I do think, gets the short straw when it comes to the action. For the first third, he's clutching his chest and fading away, but as soon as he gets to Gallifrey, these scenes really show what a great actor Davison is. In a way, Tom Baker not appearing in the special was a blessing in disguise, as I like how the current Doctor is the one to uncover Barossa as the traitor. The Fifth Doctor is one of the more human and nicer incarnations, and seeing him being disgusted at his former teacher going corrupt further emphasises the fact that the Doctor does not belong on Gallifrey, and it's no wonder he left home. I like how we go back to that feeling at the end, as the Doctor shirks his own Time Lord responsibilities and goes on the run in a rackety old TARDIS. That's the Doctor we know and love.
You know, sometimes, Tegan, you take my breath away.
When the Time Lords be very angry?
Furious.
You mean you're deliberately choosing to go on the run from your own people in a rackety old TARDIS?
Why not? After all, that's how it all started.
The returning companions all do a great job. It's great seeing the Brigadier back in unit territory, and isn't a completely comedic character like he became in his later years, but still maintaining a stiff upper lip.
Where are we going?
To the Tower. To Rassilon. The greatest single figure in Time Lord history.
Is that where he lives?
Not exactly, Brigadier. It's his tomb.
My favourite moment is when he clobbers the Master.
Killing you once was never enough for me, Doctor. How gratifying to do it 3 times over!
Nice to see you again. Boom!
With Sarah Jane returning, I do like the continuity references to K-9 and company. Despite it never being picked up for a TV series, I like how the main series Doctor Who does reference it. Despite her fall, insert quotation marks here.
What the hell was that?
I do love her interplay with the Third Doctor, and it's great that she gets to be with her very first Doctor once again. For once in the series, Tegan looks to be having a lot of fun, and even enjoying her time in the TARDIS, particularly at the Eye of Orion, feeling so content and relaxed there. Her interplay with the First Doctor is great, and I love how these two tetchy characters must work together to survive the challenges of the Dark Tower. It almost makes me wish we couldn't have got more companions mixed up with other Doctors that they hadn't met before. And yes, I'm aware Dimensions in Time exists, but let's not talk about that. Sadly, I think Susan and Turlow get the short end of the stick in this story, as both of them are stuck in the TARDIS and don't contribute anything to the main story at all. But I suppose with this many companions, not all of them can get the limelight. The Five Doctors sports many recurring enemies from the Doctor's past, even if they are brief cameos. I like the Dalek chasing the First Doctor, and being destroyed by its own firepower and revealing the disgusting mutant inside. It's a short and brief scene, but it's a memorable one nonetheless. The Cybermen look stunning in the Welsh locations, and I love the shots that show them encased in the fog. Sadly, this isn't really a story about them, and they do get the short end of the stick, being slaughtered by the Raston robot and getting tricked by the Master. They aren't really the cold and calculating machines like they are in previous stories, but it was definitely nice to see them team up with the Master, even if it did end with them being tricked. Anthony Ainley gives a fantastic performance as the Master, and I think along with Survival is his best performance on the series. The way he slimily enters the council room, grinning with sheer evilness when Barossa lists his crimes and corruption. I love his partnership with the Cybermen, and when he leads them across the giant chessboard is brilliant. As soon as he has no further need for them, he disposes of them. And one addition I do like in the special edition is that it takes 2 shots for him to finish off the Cyber leader. I love how the Master has his own agenda when it comes to immortality, even if he is unable to comprehend the Time Lords wanting him to save the Doctor. When refused help by all of them, he decides to help himself, but is knocked out by the Brigadier. The idea of Barossa being the villain is a really good idea, and if you've been watching since The Deadly Assassin, you'll notice he has changed his appearance every time the character appeared in the series, and given how corrupt the character was in The Deadly Assassin by omitting the Doctor's heroism to protect the High Council's reputation, this all feels like a step in the right direction, and not just a twist for the sake of there being a twist.
Rassilon achieved it. Timeless, perpetual, bodily regeneration. It's true immortality.
Rassilon lives, Doctor. He cannot die. He is immortal.
However, the character's own arrogance proves to be his downfall, and he does receive his immortality, but not in the way he wanted from Rassilon. Rassilon's appearance in this story is short but fantastic, and he certainly had an impact on the series even today. Even in death, he has the power to turn anyone who claims immortality to stone. It's a perfect scene that shows why no one else should seek or claim Rassilon's power. His booming voice for the special edition I think was a great addition, as the original sounded a bit too much like the host of a game show. In terms of production, The Five Doctors is pretty top-notch. The location work in North Wales is great to represent the Death Zone. The atmosphere just excels with fog and misty weather. It feels like such a forbidden place that even the Time Lords would fear, and shows how corrupt they really are when they would send life forms to fight each other for their own amusement. The cave scenes are brilliant as well. The running water and the illumination of the fire are great additions, and they do their best to hide the Yeti costume. Keeping it in the shadows was a great idea. The sets for Gallifrey all look fantastic as well, particularly the Dark Tower. The monolithic sets make it seem like this is a horrible place, warning anyone who seeks immortality to turn back or face the game of Rassilon. The tomb set is easily my favourite. The setting looks enormous and oozes with atmosphere, and I love how there's an echo effect on the actors' voices that make this place seem ancient and forbidden. The Cybermen massacre at the hands of the Rassilon robot is a great scene as well, and really showcases the robot's power and how a platoon of Cybermen is like cutting through taffy for it. The Rassilon robot is a great new addition to the story, and I would love to see it come back one day. Make it happen, Chris Chibnall. The music by Peter Howell is also fantastic. My favourite track is the Horn of Rassilon, used to show off the tower. Just through the music alone, we know how powerful Rassilon is and the might of his wrath. I particularly love the music used for the time scoop, suggesting that the laws of time don't apply anymore, and when we see Barusa's hand place the figures on the table, it adds to the mystery perfectly. I love Howell's rendition of Delia Derbyshire's original theme, as it's a very faithful adaptation, but then makes way into his current theme. It's a perfect way of honouring the past and the present. In 1995, Paul Veneses was contracted by BBC Video to produce a special edition version of the story. The serial is unique in that all the studio and location material shot during production had been achieved for posterity. This offered the intriguing possibility of being able to go back and restructure the programme for a 90s audience, using current effects technology and surround sound. The updated version of The Five Doctors began life in 1993 as a potential restoration project similar to the work on The Awakening and The Sea Devils. Veneses was a videotaper editor at BBC Pebble Mill, and whose job included transferring master material onto modern formats for editing purposes. The Five Doctors was a recording that posed quite a problem. It was the last story to be made on 2-inch videotape, and this was the first problem that had to be overcome. The tapes at 90 minutes long were very heavy and bulky, and once on the machine required an extensive lineup procedure to retrieve the best quality from them. All the recordings were transferred onto VHS and logged. It was at this point that an extended version could be released utilising all the benefits going back to the original material. This gave Veneses two options regarding the Five Doctors. The first was to re-edit the extra material back into the transmission of the programme and smudging the sound. This would have meant the music disappearing and reappearing, but this was too much of a compromise for Veneses. The second option was to completely re-edit the entire programme from scratch, with the possibility of the 1983 effects with new versions. Many of the extra material was reinstated from the beginning and ending of scenes, which were shortened in the transmitted version for timing purposes. This included a new opening shot of the exterior and interior of the Towers of Rassilon. The most notable example includes Barusa making his way to the council chamber with a new musical cue from Peter Howell. Other editing changes included some scenes being reordered to match the original script. The Cyberman, catching sight of the Doctor and the Master, no longer says, "Ah." And the squad that attempts to destroy the TARDIS have had their voices unaffected and sound less like they have been sucking on helium. All the visual effects were updated. The most notable change came from the time scoop effect. The original was a black triangle that was replaced with a translucent whirlwind, specially referred to by fans as Mr. Whippy. The time scoop turns black when it catches the Fourth Doctor, indicating a malfunction. The Dalek Raygun effect was updated to shorter beams, as well as a red effect being added onto the Dalek in the mirror maze to suggest intensifying heating when it explodes. The Thunderbolt effects that menaced the Master in the Death Zone were changed to give it a more lightning feel, as opposed to a laser. Similar effects on the checkerboard were changed as well. Scenes of the Rassilon robot disappearing were also smoothed out, and the Cybermen were seen to be shooting at the robot in the special edition instead of idly standing around. Rassilon's voice was also changed to sound deeper and more godlike. The last scene of the Fourth Doctor returning to his proper place was changed to a different clip from Sharda. The scene at the end in which the various Doctors departing their TARDISes was replaced with the Time Scoops departing instead. Producer John Nathan Turner had this to say about the Five Doctor Special Edition in 1996. Due to an oversight by BBC Video, neither Peter Moffat nor myself were involved. There has been an apology and we accept it. Nevertheless, unlike a project such as the extended version of The Curse of Fenric, where material was cut solely to prevent the episode overrunning, I believe the Five Doctors benefited from the trims that Peter and I had made. I had managed to persuade programme planning to accept an overlength programme anyway, and we both felt that we had not compromised the intention of the original. As far as I am concerned, those responsible for the so-called new version have only succeeded in turning an exciting adventure into a boring yarn. Despite what J&T might have felt about the special edition, I really do like it. The effects are a great clean-up and the extended scenes do give the programme a more relaxed feel. However, when it comes to rewatchers, I always tend to go back to the original cut, as I feel it's a much snappier version and gets the action going straight away. However, the special edition was my first experience watching this story, and it does hold a special place in my heart, and the fact that we have two versions of the story is definitely worth celebrating. The Five Doctors will definitely hold a special place in my heart. After Earthshock and Genesis of the Daleks, this was amongst my very first classic Doctor Who stories. Technically, this was the first time I had seen the first three Doctors, the Brigadier, Susan, the Master, and I even became aware that Gallifrey existed in the classic series, as the RTD era had written out the Time Lords. But the great thing about this story is that I was never confused by it. Yes, there are lots of continuity references that could confuse potential newcomers, but there was such a sense of fun and adventure that appealed to me so much as a 9-year-old that I really didn't care or get confused by everything. Whilst as a story it is overstuffed and not the most tightly written when it comes to other stories of the 80s, it more than makes up for that with its adventurous and fun tone. The Five Doctors, when you get down to it, is a massive party. It's a celebration of how wonderful Doctor Who is and having its cake and eating it in every scene it can. The Five Doctors is best enjoyed with a fizzy drink, jelly babies and plenty of friends, particularly ones that you meet at conventions. Whenever we say goodbye after a convention, it always reminds me of when the Four Doctors say goodbye at the end. It may have been a short but sweet meeting, but the memories and adventures we've had along the way are always worth remembering. After all, that's how it all started.